Our next session, we have Steve Conklin, and he is here to give us a status update on the AMSAT Geosynchronous Satellite.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Before I start, all the paper and some additional information about things that I'm going to talk about are all at this repository URL at the end, and the slides will be posted. And I will possibly add new things to the additional resources file that's there based on questions or whatever we get into. I'm here to talk about the Phase 4B ground station platform. Now, that's a lot of words that are contextual, and we'll hopefully cover all of that, and you'll understand what all those words mean before we get finished here today. My name is Steve Conklin. My amateur radio call sign is Alpha India 4, Quebec Romeo. The view on the right is the view from next to my antenna on the roof of my house toward Tasmania, 16,000 kilometers. And I have made contacts here, mostly with digital modes that allow low power and digital communications. I don't think I have a single voice sideband contact with Tasmania, although I have a number with Australia. My history is that I'm a hardware engineer by training. I've done embedded software, and for the last 20 years, mostly been tied up in various software things, but I still fool with hardware as a hobby. Probably the most fun thing I've got going right now is that I backported a kernel driver for a manufacturer of a commercial amateur radio device that was a mess, but it ended up in their product, and then it ended up getting included in the GLASS project, which is a maritime tracking safety experiment that's orbiting on the ISS right now. So by a circuitous path, I have code running on orbit right now. Now, this project is amazing, and I'm going to tell you why. It covers an intersection of amateur radio, networking, signal processing, platform design, Linux, connectivity, public service through emergency communications, and at least the ground portion of this project is 100% open. And we're actively recruiting. This is going to ramp up over the next year or two. We're in the very early stages of a lot of this right now. Amateur radio itself is a rabbit hole. And if you're not, I know who are hams. There is so much here that you can spend a lifetime getting bored with one part of it and then pivoting to another and still not run out of things to do. Amateur radios, operators, they talk to people locally, around the world, they build hardware. There was a presentation at the MiniConf on Monday about bouncing low power signals off of the moon and receiving them again at very tiny power levels, down to 5 watts and 2 watts of radiated power. That's a phenomenal accomplishment. We do things like bounce radio signals off of meteor trails during meteor showers to talk to other amateur radio operators because it's cool and we can do it. Not for any other reason other than it's cool. There are contesting and there's radio sport where people run through the brush with directional antennas and try to race each other to find the transmitter before anyone else. There's just so much there that I couldn't possibly describe it. So this is my slide, and I encourage you to go down this rabbit hole. Radio amateurs, through their experimentation, have participated in many, many innovations through our technological history, including packet radio, mesh networking, signal processing, like the technologies that are used to bounce these signals off the moon. And there's a new revival beginning. We're poised right now to have this convergence of digital processing ability, networking, radio, software-defined radio, AI, cognitive radio, and to have an open source framework that lets us do some really, really amazing things. But we're here to talk about the satellite part of that. This is a screenshot of an application called G-Predict. It's an open source piece of software that shows you the satellites that are in orbit, the ones you want to see, and the ground footprint that is visible to them. And it's used for amateurs to determine when they can communicate with satellites. Now, as of January 2nd, these were all the satellites that are amateur satellites that were in the sky. They're not all functional, but there are a huge number of amateur radio satellites in the sky. The vast majority of them are in low Earth orbit, so that they pass over very quickly, and you have about a 10-minute window or less during which you can communicate using those. Some relay communications like that. Some only broadcast telemetry so that you can pick up information about the batteries on the satellite or that sort of information. The vast majority that allow communications can be used with an introductory amateur radio license, which in most countries is fairly easy to achieve. The barrier to entry to this as a hobby is quite low. AMSAT is a worldwide collection of organizations to involve amateurs with building and flying satellites. It's a volunteer-run nonprofit organization in most countries, and this project is part of AMSAT North America. It's virtually impossible for a group of amateurs to actually build a booster and get a payload into orbit. So the typical path to orbit for amateur satellites is a ride share, where either on a commercial or a test flight or a government flight, there's a ring of payload that ejects satellites either along the way or on orbit. Or occasionally we're given space on a satellite, communication satellite that has space for us, that, and we're given typically a volume, a power budget, and a place to put an antenna. And Phase 4B is that sort of project. CubeSats are by far the most popular satellite now that is up for amateur use. And we have a picture of one of those on the next slide here. The Phase 4 designation that is a designation that amateur satellites are placed in depending on their capabilities and the type of orbit they're in. Phase 1 is a very short-lived satellite that may only make one or fewer orbits, battery power only. Phase 2 have solar cells, typically are in a low Earth orbit, have a longer life, but because they're in a low Earth orbit, they have a very short visibility to the ground as they go over. Phase 3 are longer lived. They usually have a command and control structure. They're often in high Earth orbit. Now, the top satellite here is a CubeSat, which is likely a Phase 2 project. The photo on the lower left is of AO40, which was a Phase 3 satellite, and some people here will recognize Bedel Garby. I understand, this is my first LCA, I understand this is the first year in 15 years that he was not at LCA, so I'm sorry to have missed him. And he's representative of the huge overlap that there is between core people in the open source development community and a lot of the things that have been happening in amateur radio over the last 20 years. Phase 4 is a geosynchronous or geostationary satellite that is in a high Earth orbit that's synchronized with the daily rotation of the Earth so that it's more or less in the same point in the sky and visible to a certain part of the Earth 24 hours a day. There have been no successful or even attempted Phase 4 missions yet, and there's one that Phase 4A, the very first one, is going to fly in the SHEL-2 mission, and that's being run by AMSAT UK. SHEL is a communications and television satellite being launched by the nation of Qatar, and AMSAT UK is coordinating with them. The project that I'm involved with is AMSAT Phase 4B, and that's a project that AMSAT North America is working on. And we have a ride on a government-sponsored payload that they've given us space on. They will likely launch before us. Nobody has a fixed launch schedule yet. Part of that is because of the SpaceX launch slips that have thrown everything into chaos. They're back in business now. So hopefully soon we'll begin to have an idea. But space is hard. Things break, missions get bumped, and no one ever really knows until the day that you launch that you're good to go. Conventional transponders on amateur radio satellites receive a band of frequencies and then retransmit them typically on another band of frequencies. There are other packet radio methodologies, but this is the most common that people use. They're called bent pipe transponders, and you use a remote on your handheld or your satellite ground station, and you transmit an FM signal, for example, and it comes back down shifted with a Doppler shift, of course, because the satellite is moving. And if you tune that, you can have a communication between two points. Phase four will not be like that. Phase four is going to be 100% digital, packetized, and channelized. We don't provide voice communication, we provide packets. And if you want to put voice on top of that, well, that'll be an application that you run on platform, and then you can choose their open codecs. Codec 2 is an open project that just in the last few days announced that they've achieved intelligible voice with 700 bits per second. Phenomenal. Intelligible does not mean high quality, but it is intelligible, and it's amazing. Phase four, in a sense, since we're going to allow connected data streams between applications on the Earth, is a router in the sky. Now, this is awesome for a lot of reasons. It's not limited to short passes. You can have a long-term connection. It's easy to integrate with other existing networks because the ground station is itself a server. We have the ability to partition traffic. This is one of the fundamental design decisions that's being made to support emergency communications. Now, this is important for a number of reasons. You'll be able to use this in a disaster zone where there's no terrestrial infrastructure at all to communicate with people outside of the disaster zone. The U.S. government and the Federal Emergency Management Association have expressed a lot of interest in this. And in fact, if there or when there is a commercial version of the ground station available that you can buy off the shelf, they have committed to buy them and deploy them for emergency areas. So there's a huge public service component here. But we're reserving the ability to partition traffic with authentication so that we can assign a series of channels that are available for emergency traffic only and partition that traffic so that malicious actors can't mess around with it. This is really, there are two projects to phase 4B, the flight half and the ground station half. The flight side is being run out of Virginia Tech University by Dr. Bob McGuire. Bob is third from the left in this photograph. He has put together various sponsors and government entities and open source communities, and we get a space on the satellite, a power budget, and a place to put antennas. And it's not much space on the satellite. There's a video that's linked to in the resources that are at this repo. The software-defined radio board that's radiation-hardened that's going on the satellite is about the size of my hand. The compute power that you can get in a small board these days is enough to put on orbit and handle 100 or 1,000 channels of digital communication. The ground side is managed by Michelle Thompson, and this is the project that I'm personally part of. Now, Michelle is second from the right in that photograph next to Phil Karn. Some of you people might know Phil as well. He's made contributions to many, many parts of things that we care about. The ground side is completely open. Now, what I haven't said so far is the flight side is not open, and it can't be open. And this has been a restriction on amateur satellite projects forever. And it has to do with government rules about ITAR, which are the same rules that govern the export of cryptography and other things like that. It has to do with restrictions that are placed upon the project by the host, and restrictions upon things like control telemetry for objects on the satellite and control over who can upload firmware to the satellite, because obviously if you have a radio in space that is totally reprogrammable, you don't want that falling into the wrong hands. There's potential for disruption. This has been a blocker in the past to international communication on amateur radio projects. And by splitting the project into a ground side and an earth side, we can have a totally open ground side because we're working to standards. We're working to standards that we can both work to and experiment with and verify the operation of independently. Now, but I don't live in the US. A lot of people here don't live in the US. The initial satellite will have coverage from probably the west coast of Africa to somewhere off the west coast of the United States. But the ground station design uses space and terrestrial application of the DVB-S and DVB-T standards, and I'll talk about those in a minute. So the station design fundamentally is open for either space or terrestrial use, and this means that you can use the basic station design and the associated hardware to set up the same satellite on a hilltop, or terrestrial data links, or mesh networking, or anything else that you want to do. And so it becomes a platform for all sorts of radio and connectivity development. The sort of stack that we're using right now is 5 gigahertz uplink to the satellite and 10 gigahertz down. It's full duplex. We want this to be usable with an entry-level license, and we want to camp everyone on these bands. We want amateurs all over these bands because bands are under pressure by commercial interest, and these are valuable bands, and they are underutilized. This is another place where having a public service aspect will help us a lot. We'd like to use a single small antenna for both the 5 gig uplink and the 10 gigahertz downlink. This is a challenge. Some people here, does anybody know why that's a challenge? Any guesses? That's exactly right. The one frequency is exactly twice the other, and it's a harmonic of the first. And if you're transmitting on 5 gigahertz, you have a lot of 5 gigahertz energy at the ground station, but you're trying to receive a very weak signal that's at twice that frequency. There's a project member who is well respected, and I am not going to name him because I think he's got a paper coming out very soon. Microwave design can be as much mechanical as it is electrical, or at a certain geometry they are the same thing. And it looks like he's designed a feed horn that has enough isolation at these two frequencies to make this work, to get 5 and 10 gigahertz full duplex on a 36-inch dish. That by itself is an amazing accomplishment to the open world of microwaves and amateur radio. And there are a number of other things on this project that have the potential to be just as important. DVB-S2 and DVB-T are the standards that we're working to. These are television broadcast standards that are used for satellite and terrestrial communications. That's what the S and the T stand for. Now, would anyone want to make a guess why they're different? Why is space different from terrestrial? It's because of multipath and reflections. If you're pointed an antenna at space, there's nothing else there interfering with your signal. But on the ground, you have reflections from buildings and mountains and things like that. And the standards are different to account for that. There are reference designs and dedicated chips available for DVB, and they're relatively cheap now because they're used in a lot of consumer products. They can be implemented in FPGA, although we're working on a good open source implementation. And there's another standard called GSE, which is generic stream encapsulation, which is data encapsulation within a DVB stream. It's a data link layer protocol, and there are people on the team who are already experimenting with that, and they've made great progress on that. This is a major sub-project for the Phase 4 ground station. We're going to demodulate and decode on the satellite, and there are a couple of reasons for that. The first reason is that we've halved the error detection path length. If you have a bit error or you're not transmitting packets that can be received, and we just simply retransmit that signal, then someone on the ground has to first of all know that that packet's for them. They have to detect that there's an error, and then they have to get it all the way back from the satellite to you that you have an error in the packet and it didn't check some or whatever. The satellite generally is more able to transmit to you than you are to it, if we've done the system correctly. So we do the decode and demodulation and depacketizing on the satellite, and then do authentication and authorization on the satellite. And the authentication and authorization is a big, hairy ball of problems that we've only begun to have a discussion about how we're going to implement. There were some interesting discussions at this conference about related topics having to do with online authentication, and I'm sure this community can bring a lot of smart thought to that. Channelization allows many independent users all at the same time, and it allows us to partition channels for use for emergency services, for example. It'll be implemented as many channels up, meaning many different bands of frequency up on the 5 gigahertz band, which will be filtered into individual bands by either an FPGA or a DSP on the satellite. It'll be DSP on the satellite because that's what we have that's radiation hardened. And then a single channel downlink with time division multiplexing. So as a user connects to the satellite and is authorized, they'll be given a time slot. And this gives us the ability to do, and this has been proven with a four-channel implementation already, and this will give us the ability to do things like set up the equivalent of the P25 talk groups and other things where we can multicast, and it'll be application-driven, but if you were using a voice codec, you could have multiple receivers, a party line sort of setup. It's undecided, but it's likely to either be 1,000 channels of 10 megahertz bandwidth or 100 channels of 100 megahertz bandwidth. So we're talking about aggregate, a lot of bandwidth for the satellite. This, and there's been discussion of channel bonding for uplink to give you wider bandwidth on a single ground station for an uplink, but this is problematic and complicates things a lot, including the RF power amplifier designs for the ground station, because you have problems that cropped up due to the bandwidth of the actual power amplifier. And so it's likely that we will not be able to bond uplink channels, although there are still a lot of people on the RF side that are having these discussions. Channels will be assignable, and we're going to need a free and open polyphase filter to implement this and decode all of those channels. That's in very early R&D right now. There are no good open implementations of a polyphase filter right now, and that's one of our more interesting projects. The ground station platform is a radio server. There's not going to be a UI. There will be APIs. It'll be a network jack. And initially, this will be homebrew lashups of dedicated, maybe a software-defined radio, or a laptop plus an SDR box, or a board like the Pink that has a FPGA on it. And people will, you know, different developers will hack on this in different ways. But we're going to move toward an integrated station design that will be, this is general purpose computer plus special hardware, but it'll likely be a specially designed hardware that will have an ARM processor, Linux OS, and either a dedicated DVB chip or FPGA on it. Now, having this on a generalized Linux platform means that we're easily connectable to, if you have a network available, connected to cloud apps, to logging applications, to other stations and relays, and it just becomes another way to pass pass data. We want to make this work with one or two small dishes. The goal is one, but if we have to, we'll use two. Transverters, RF amplifiers, and the details of that are all to be determined, but the flight side people have already put some little mock-ups together using commercial off-the-shelf things that aren't too expensive, and that I don't think those are going to be a big problem. There is a plan for a commercial product. Flex Radio, who builds software-defined radios, has expressed an interest in producing that, and they're willing to produce a commercial product that's based on an open source implementation that we provide them. So I think that's pretty awesome. And FEMA is interested in buying that. We have a bunch of ancillary projects. One of these is a QSO or QSO logging and visualization program. It's cloud-based. The skeleton is done. It's a Ruby Rails app. The framework is in place. We have an example of a visualization. But this is just yet another part of the project that allows people with a multitude of different skills to jump into. We would love to have people with more visualizations. We don't actually put the data in the database yet. This is just beginning to come together, but we use the ADIF file format, which is a well-established amateur radio file format for logging contacts. And so one of the things on our list, for example, is a generalized Ruby gem for handling ADIF data and validating that and putting it into a database. So this is an example of one of the side projects we have. Identification and authorization is a tough project. We need to assure compliance with licensing, and because we are using bands that are licensed, we need to allow channel reservations and allocate those for emergency use and things like that. It doesn't need to be dependent on connectivity, so we can't hand out tokens through a web server to people in a disaster zone. That just won't work. And we need to be able to revoke people's ability to use the device. And this is important for a number of reasons, including the fact that it's very difficult to tell where people are when they're using a satellite like this with a 5 and a 10 gigahertz connection. So one can imagine malicious actors, whether they're terrorists or Somalian pirates or any other sort of people who have an interest in long-distance communication, having them use this would be a problem, and it would be taken away from us. We're going to have to police ourselves on this or be policed. Now, there are some authentication and identification schemes or methods that are already used. We will likely implement something similar to Amateur Radio Relay League's logbook of the world, and although it has to be international. Their method is to send a physical token, a postcard, to the postal address of record of a licensee, and then complete that chain to sign a digital key. And this all has to be figured out, and I know there are people who are experts in it, and I'd like for them to help. User applications, text, digital, voice modes. There are a bunch of these already for amateur radio, and there are a bunch of off-the-shelf solutions for text that, say, text chat. There's, in essence, there's no reason you can't take an IRC client on each end and communicate through the satellite using the data link layer. But there are some challenges due to latency and due to restrictions by law. You are not allowed to have an obfuscated or encrypted set of information pass through an amateur radio band. You can encode it using conventional encodings or a published encoding that can be decoded, but you can't obfuscate it. And this means, for example, that you can't just blindly forward an SSL connection or an SSH tunnel through a satellite like this. That is forbidden by US law for amateur radios and most of the other amateur radio restrictions in the world. If you want to have a voice mode communication, that just becomes something that has a codec and a decoder, and those sorts of apps exist, but they'll need to be ported to the platform and supported by the open source community. Current status, the flight hardware team now has done the link budgets, although I saw a revision yesterday. They're still working on this. they're going to begin doing terrestrial testing. They've built some little ground station mock-ups that are just using small antennas and GNU radio on both ends. They're not actually doing any of the digital modes yet, but they're using this to measure signal strength terrestrially and point-to-point, and they're going to put these on buildings and mountaintops and begin doing that sort of testing to see if their calculations for the link budget. Link budget is basically I have 1 watt here, and I have an antenna that's this good, and now I've got to go through this many thousands of miles, and I lose X amount of signal, and in the end, how good does my receiver have to be to receive that? And that's the process they've been going through for quite a while now. DVB development on the ground team has made great progress. There's still a lot to do. They've been using GNU radio, Wireshark, and some FPGA development, as well as some software-defined radio projects, a multitude of different ones. There are people using Red Pataya and one of the early Lime SDRs. They were nice enough to see our project as fitting for winning their contest for an early release of Lime SDR. And they've been comparing commercial chip implementations of DVB with the FPGA implementations to see which one makes sense for us. Polyphase filters are going to be really important for us. It's a problem that has to run on the satellite side, since we need to decode a whole bunch of parallel frequency bandwidths on the uplink. But the goal of this is also to be able to deploy what is essentially a satellite on the ground for terrestrial applications. So it's a generalized problem that in the long run applies to the whole project. And so this is the problem of, given this huge swath of frequencies, how do you divide that up into individual data streams? And we're working on a good open implementation that we can release to the public. And there's a lot of talk. This is very early discussion right now. And this will be either an FPGA or a DSP implementation. These days, they're largely the same once you get them written in a language that can be built by the tools. The ground station platform design, this is where this community is particularly going to be interested, I think. The intent is to have a Linux platform, and details will depend on the additional hardware that we are needed for that. The decisions haven't all been made, but we do have a general feel for how it's going to work. I am the platform lead. I don't want to be the platform developer. I don't mind helping, but I really am here to recruit. We have a lot of decisions, and the early stations will probably involve laptops and platforms like Red Pataya, Lime SDR, and other things like that. There are some commercial chips for DVB that are on evaluation boards that are under evaluation by some team members. There is also a box that one of the members is evaluating that has a network jack on the back, and you just get the data stream out of the gigabit port, which is pretty cool. And I don't know, it's a few hundred dollars for that. So if it works, and what he's doing is he's testing to make sure it works with generic stream encapsulation and all of that sort of thing. So we're going to build a platform, and then we're going to start fielding lots of apps. And that'll be a separate talk for more recruiting. So if you'd like to contribute, you can find us on GitHub. It's GitHub Phase 4 Ground. And then we have a page where we sort of keep a little bit of status. There's an AMSAT team sign up that we'd like to have you complete so that there's a record with AMSAT North America that you're participating. There's an ITAR only warning, which is going to look really scary for anyone outside the United States or who's not a citizen. You can ignore that if you're working on the ground station. Chat is through Slack. It's very, very active. There's a lot of interesting stuff that happens there, and there are a lot of it's like sitting at the lunch table with people who are smarter than you on certain topics and just kind of keeping your mouth shut. I find that Slack for this project is educational to me in a lot of different areas that I really don't know much about, because this is a very multidisciplinary project. So there's a lot going on there in multiple channels. And then there's a YouTube channel with weekly reports that Michelle has produced going quite far back now, and keeping everyone up on status. And there's a lot of good information there that'll kind of give you a feel for how we're progressing week to week on things. There's also a video that I linked to in the resources, which are associated with the first repo link that I put up. That is a presentation by Bob McGuire about what the flight side team is working on. If you want to just follow along, and if something interests you, speak up, that's cool. I got into this just because it was cool. Bob McGuire, at one point eating lunch with him, I said, Bob, the next time you get a really interesting project, just count me in. I don't know what I can do, you know. And so I ended up in this project and didn't really know how I could contribute, but as time went on, there were more and more things that popped up that I realized that I knew how to do, and it was awesome to be able to help. You can follow along and ask questions, you can introduce yourself, and the weekly reports, again, are a really good way to keep up. That's all I have. I skipped over a lot of stuff, so I welcome questions, and we can go off and talk about each of those.
All righty. Yes. Oh, I'll come back to you.
Hi, I just wanted to know how the proposed satellite's going to work with geomagnetic storms and things like that.
I'm having trouble hearing you.
I just wanted to know how the proposed satellite is going to handle solar issues like geomagnetic storms and particles, things like that.
Well, those are huge problems that we as our amateur organization can't solve. And that's an area where, since we're riding on someone else's payload, we're not likely to have any input into whether they shut that satellite down or turn it. Common strategies for that are to turn the antennas away from the stream or to turn things off or shut it down. It's very rare to have to do that, but we're at the people that we're flying on will have the ability to turn us off. And this is what will happen if we don't manage ourselves well, is they'll just turn off our power. But we don't have a lot of control over what they do with the satellite.
Is there any crossover or collaboration technically or personally with other ground station projects, such as some of those that work with some of the satellites in low Earth orbit like CubeSats?
There are a lot of people on this project who have worked with a lot of different technologies, and there are several Qualcomm engineers who have worked with cell phone technology and space technology before. The people on the flight side project have worked with a number of space side technologies. And so we do, as far as the RF and modulation and that sort of space and telephone technologies for modulation schemes and that sort of encoding, we have a huge amount of experience on the team. Yeah.
Phil Karn's on your team here, and Phil Karn did the uplink encoding for the FOX satellites for the telemetry.
To be fair, yes, Phil is on the team.
As far as I know, he's done all amateur radio telemetry encoding schemes for the last 50 years, but.
Phil is the first guy. So for the people here who don't know Phil, among other things, was the first to use forward error correction in an amateur satellite setup, which at the time was revolutionary. Now, forward error correction, if you're a communications engineer, is sort of the salt that you sprinkle on things as you build them, and it makes them better. Phil has done so many things. You can find he's probably named on 50 RFCs for various networking schemes. He was one of the people involved in the, if you recall, the IC3 satellite that came back after 30 years and all the equipment was dead and no one knew how to demodulate it, and it was an odd Viterbi coding that the hardware that was built to decode it wasn't around anymore, and Phil figured that out, and they attempted to revive that satellite. That was another one of his. And he's on the mailing list, and he's active occasionally in IRC, and he doesn't say much, but when he does, I read every word that he writes. Very interesting guy. He also wrote an operating system for packet radio that was the only thing going for a long time.
Is there anyone else? Yes.
I'm curious about the restrictions on encrypted transmissions. Is that likely to stand over the long term? Is that a very long-standing thing with amateur radio?
That is a very long-standing restriction. It's been a restriction since the beginning of the amateur, almost the beginning of the amateur radio licensing. And it will be a restriction forever. When amateur radio was first codified in rules and regulations by federal governments, they were pretty terrified that amateur radio would compete with commercial telecommunications. And so there are a number of restrictions on amateur radio that are all kind of designed to do that. Now, I don't think the encryption and obfuscation law is for that. I think it's because they want to know what you're talking about. And we've been through times of war in the past where they've actually shut down the amateur service in the United States, and it was illegal to use it at all. And that could happen again. Governments do things, and we're at their mercy. The laws that were passed as part of the service that were due to non-compete with commercial entities have to do with not taking money for passing traffic, not having a pecuniary interest is the exact wording that they use or using it for a business. You can use encoding, and a lot of digital communication is encoded, but those are publicly available standards, and anyone can decode them.
Hi, I got a couple of questions. What is the power budget for this, in terms of how much does it cost to run the satellite up there, and how long will it stay up once it is up?
I don't know. They haven't told me. I don't know that they've told the flight side team. It's very expensive to launch a satellite, and I'm not even sure what the rest of the payload on the satellite is going to do. The cost, did I say the goal for the cost of the ground station complete for it? Our design goal, I can't believe I left this out, packable by one person, 36-inch possibly collapsible dish, under $1,000 US. That's the design goal for the station.
All right, well, that's pretty much going to take us up to afternoon tea. So thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
And on behalf of the conference, we do have a little gift to thank you for coming along and giving us such a fantastic talk.